Hey, good afternoon. I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. This is the first one of 2023. My name is Craig Gleckler. I'm the marketing manager at CUES, and I'll be your host for today. For today's topic, we will be discussing the use of sonar in sewer inspections. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our speaker for today's presentation, Mr. Ed Diggs. Ed, take it away.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for attending this. I imagine there's some of you in the crowd there that probably have more experience on sonar than I do, but I hope that what you find today will be interesting and useful to you. I've been working for CUES for 22 years, and before that, I had about 10 years with RS Technical Services, so I'm currently the executive treasurer on the Southeast Society for Trenchless Technologies board, and really enjoy working the sewer industry. So I hope we have some fun and some interesting information available for you today, and look forward to this presentation. So, sonar. Sonar is not what we call a new technology. It is actually an ancient or old technology, one that's been around. I first came upon it when I came to CUES 22 years ago. CUES had sold two sonar units, one to a contractor, one to a municipality, and it was intriguing to me, and so I decided to approach it with other municipalities and contractors and see if we couldn't sell more. At the time, it was kind of limited because you needed two cable reels to be able to run it and be able to run sonar and a camera at the same time. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. But it's made great advancements since 22 years ago. And so basically, sonar profiling is an imaging method that utilizes high frequency, short range sonars to provide visual images of sewer pipelines. It is frequently used in applications where CCTV visual methods are not feasible due to waterline conditions and lack of retrievable information. Sonar profiling can provide accurate data, including pipe cross-section properties, pipe deformation, silt level, obstructions, deviations, etc. And that's according to the Trenchlesspedia. An acronym that is used in many contracts or bids that are out there is calling out for TISCIT. And TISCIT is an acronym that actually, I believe it was Alan McCloskey who came up with this verbiage, TISCIT, which is totally integrated sonar and CCTV inspection technique. So if you see people using the word TISCIT in their contracts, or if they're using it around you, now you know what it means. Try to remember that, but at least you know the main gist is that it's just sonar and TV at the same time. So let's take a look at sonar and what the SSO nationwide statistics actually look like. That the sustainability to keep our infrastructure going is going to take over $1 trillion. In order to keep us up and running. Annual sewer overflows are over 2 million. Sewage that's discharged in raw sewage, discharged into rivers and streams, equals about 50 billion US gallons per year. In 2012, this city had 34 CSOs, combined storm sewers, and dumped about 2 billion gallons a year untreated waste into the Cuyahoga and Little Cuyahoga rivers, the Ohio and Erie Canal. In underdeveloped countries, 10 trillion U.S. gallons of untreated sewage per year. Makes you want to go swimming, huh? So this particular municipality that I'm showing you here decided to take it on and go in and utilize Sonar to help them in their cleaning process. And as you can see, they normally spent there around $2 million in cleaning in large diameter pipe, and we're talking 18 inch and above, every year. But by utilizing Sonar to determine whether it needed cleaning or not, they were able, in a three-year period of time, save over $5 million in cleaning cost, or $4.5 million to be exact, not over five. So Sonar is very helpful in determining how to clean your pipe. Before I get into this Sonar report, let's talk about why Sonar is so important. In large diameter pipe, it's pretty much normal, and we're talking 18 inch and above. You really don't need Sonar below 18 inch in diameter. Then 18 inch, you may not need it either, but 24 and above, you definitely need Sonar to utilize Sonar. So if you're in a municipality with a lot of 24 inch and above diameter, then Sonar can increase your cleaning production. It can help you stop a lot of overflows and give you a lot of information on that pipe that you may not be able to get with your regular CCTV. The other thing is that if you have siphons in your municipality, and most all do, you have a river, a lake, something that you're going under, and it's usually surcharged all the time, Sonar can go in and give you all the information you need there as well. Now, Sonar's greatest asset is determining how much debris is inside of a pipe. And you might say, well, you know, what does that mean? Why do I need that? And it's really kind of simple, because in your smaller diameter pipe, which you're inspecting all the time, you've got it down pretty well. The pipe's clean, but you're still having manholes that pop up during wet weather events. And you know the line's clean. You know there's no problem there. You've taken care of it all. There's no roots. There's no fog. There's nothing, but it's still popping that manhole. And every time there's a wet weather event and the phones start ringing or the alarms start going off, you know exactly which manholes are flooding, because it's the same ones all the time. There's a good reason for that. Those are your lowest lying manholes. And it's just like a backup. If you've ever had a backup in your house on the sewer system, how the first place it shows up is in your shower or bathtub or both, and then the toilets, and then up into the sinks. Hopefully it doesn't get to that. But those are the low lying spots inside your home. So the same way it is in the sewers is that the low-lying spots are going to take the brunt of a blockage somewhere inside the pipe. So we have what's called cleaning. And you send the combo trucks, vac trucks, jet trucks out to go clean the pipe. And yet the pipe may not need to be cleaned. So there's a waste of time, a waste of money. Another thing that happens is that a lot of municipalities will contract out the cleaning for the 18-inch and above pipe. And when they do, some engineer came up with this, and most of the time I agree with engineers, but I don't agree with this philosophy, is that they come up in the contract requiring you to have that pipe 98% clean. Well, how do they know it's 98% clean? Well, they say when you pull back clean water, that's when it's 98% clean. Now, there's a problem with that, because if you're pulling back and you've got all the big stuff and now you're fighting the sand and silt in the water, it doesn't take very much to keep the water looking dirty. And so let's say maybe there was 30 cubic yards of debris in the pipe and you pulled back 29 cubic yards of debris in the pipe, the water's still going to be dirty, but the pipe is actually clean. Case in point is that I use this example, and I'm sure most of you have probably heard it before from me, is that when you sweep into a dustpan and you pick that dustpan up, there's a little line sitting there. So you sweep that little line into a ball and you sweep it into the dustpan and you pick up the dustpan. And guess what? There's a little line sitting there. So you do it again. You do it again. And then you take the broom and you move that little line out the door or under a mat or something, because it's always there. So that's what happens in cleaning pipe. So when you clean pipe and you're trying to get it to come back with clear water, you've gotten the majority of the debris out of there, and there's a cubic yard or half a cubic yard or even less than that sitting inside that pipe, and you spend the next 3 to 4 hours working on that little tiny bit of sand and silt in order to meet the requirement of pulling back clear water. Total waste of time, total waste of money, doesn't make any sense. So with sonar, if you ran the sonar in there and you knew how much debris was inside the pipe, and you knew when you filled your trucks, your cleaning trucks, how much debris you'd put in them, then you would know that, hey, this pipe's clean. And let's face it, if you knew that there was only a cubic yard of debris inside the pipe, you wouldn't even have gone in to clean it anyway. Now, some municipalities require those who clean to do a post sonar to determine that it's clean or that it's 98%. And they make them use calculations and everything else to come up on the pile heights that are stuck in the joints and things like that. So that's a little smarter. Originally, in the old days, before software came out that was capable of giving the information of the debris, people would do what is called step cleaning, meaning they would go in and grab a little bit and then grab a little bit more. Now, the nice thing with step cleaning is if you are right in what you're doing, when you come back with your final pass out at the end, you'll be pulling back clear water. So that takes care of it. But if you overshoot on just one of those grabs, you're back to dealing with the dirty water for hours on end. So I'm going to share with you a couple of different sonar reports and what's available to you information-wise by utilizing sonar. This one right here, as you can see, is 1,043 feet long of concrete encased steel pipe. It's a 66-inch diameter pipe. The water level in this pipe is 66 inches. So this is a fully surcharged 66-inch diameter pipe. The sediment inside that pipe, 470 cubic yards. The as-built capacity of the pipe is at 49%. So remember when I was talking about how it's backing up into those manholes? If the trunk line that is headed to the treatment plant is only operating at 50%, you're going to get backups into that nice clean pipe that you've taken care of with your cleaning. So, the average height of the sediment in this pipe is 32.5 inches, and the maximum depth of it is 44 inches, at leaving only 22 inches at 840 feet. Keep that in mind, because we'll take a look at that here in a minute. So, when you look at the graph down on the bottom there, the blue is the water in the pipe. You wish it was, but it's not really that way in the sewers, as we all know. The green is showing the debris. So as you look at that for the full 1,046 feet, look at that green and see how much debris is in there. Do you think you have a capacity problem? Definitely. So, you know that the sediment height, you can look at it there following the graph there at the 800 to 1,000 feet. You see the 44 inches, the tallest point there. And you can see what the problem is inside that pipe. Now, you might be saying, well, wow, that's you know, a rarity. It's not a rarity. It's not rare. This is seen in large diameter pipe lots of times because it's never really been inspected, and a lot of them have never been cleaned. So therefore, this is common, and instead of paying the fines of the overflows, you can put a little bit of money into Sonar, and you can get all of your large diameter taken care of. So when you look at an individual or cross-section type of graph here, you'll notice that 840 feet, 837 feet, you see the debris that is there and how small the actual capacity is there of the pipe that was meant to take this and keep moving. Now, you know, an interesting thing is probably about 15 years ago when I started really getting into Sonar, I went to do a presentation for a large municipality, and the director of engineering said, do you have anything besides large diameter pipe to present? And I said, no. And he said, well, then we're done. We don't have any problems with our large diameter pipe. And I said, really, how do you know that? And he said, well, because, you know, it's simple fact. Large diameter pipe, if you've got flow, you can't have any debris. So that was the school of thought for many municipalities for many years, and many engineers that did that. Most of them have all changed their mind on it because of the advancements of Sonar and multi-sensor. They have learned to change their minds and realize that, whoa, these things can get debris backups in it. And it's not uncommon to do that. So therefore, you can see where you might be having the same problems where Sonar would help you out. Now, getting back to the cleaning process, if you know that you have, let's go back. If you know that you actually have, go back one more in here, that you actually have 470 cubic yards of debris in there, then you know, based on how much your trucks can handle, whether it's 10 cubic yards, or it's 10 cubic yards, you know, you're looking at that 400, aren't you? You know how many truckloads you're going to be taking out of there. And then from there, you can go over here to this graph and you see the actual debris, and you can calculate based on the depth of each point where each one of those 10 cubic yards are going to be. So then you can come in and go into that footage. Let's say it's right here at 50 feet. You go in, you pull that 50 feet, then you come in and pull the next 50 feet, et cetera, until you get down to the end. And when you pull it back, you will be pulling back clean water. But that really doesn't, like I say, if you can get them to buy into it, it doesn't matter, because if you had 470 cubic yards of debris and you got out 469 cubic yards of debris, I'd say you have a lot more capacity in that pipe than what they ever thought they would have. So that's where this comes into play and helps you out in your cleaning process. It also helps out because if you're contracting it out into bids, it'll come out to bid as light cleaning, medium cleaning, heavy cleaning. Now, how do you know? But if you knew, then you could state this line over here is heavy cleaning. This line over here is light cleaning. And so therefore, pricing would be fair to the contractors bidding on it. And everybody, the change orders would go away, everything. And so therefore, it behooves you to turn around and go with Sonar before cleaning. Another report, which we do in Granite Net, can handle everything for you. And this particular pipe, it's not very dirty. I mean, you run into things, people say, well, you know, I bought the Sonar and I don't have any problems. It's like, yeah, well, aren't you glad to know that? So in this particular graph, you can see that you got a small amount of sediment in the pipe, and that the 187 cubic feet of debris in the pipe. And that from here up at the top, you've got some grease that is built up there on the top of the pipe in that area from, say, 250 feet to about 360 feet. So it's not really taking out that much, 4.6 inches, averaging 2.5 inches of loss in the top. So in all reality, if you'd run this through there, maybe you want to go back in, or maybe you just want to say, you know what, let's go for another 5 years and look at it again and determine whether it needs to be cleaned. Because let's say that this pipe had never been inspected or never cleaned in 25 years, and this was all that developed in 25 years, then it's easy to assume that you've got some extra time available by utilizing the report. So here's the things that the Sonar reporting can do for you. It can accurately measure your distances between two points in the pipe. You can overlay a cross-sectional outline of the pipe based on standard pipe shapes. And what that does is, let's say the as-built, and just a word of caution to you in case you know this, sometimes as-builts aren't correct. I know that's hard to believe, isn't it? But that does happen. So you can overlay, let's say that they said that the pipe was 66 inches in diameter. You can overlay a 66-inch template in there up against that pipe. So you're able to determine, too, at that point in time, if that's there, whether you have any wall loss in the pipe or any deformity in the pipe, et cetera, in there. So you have that ability with the Granite Net sonar module. You can automatically detect the water level. So you're able to say exactly how much water is inside that pipe, how high the water level is. And you can create an outline of the pipe cross-section that's detected by the sonar. You can create sediment observations like we talked about before. You can create water level observations. And you can output your sonar data to a standard video file. So, with the sonar, the distances that you can go, if you're operating in the smaller diameter pipe, with a CUES steerable pipe ranger or regular pipe ranger, you can go up to 1,000 feet on the gold cable in sonar and with the camera on top, Tiscat mode. Now, if you go to the steerable Mudmaster, which if you haven't used before, man, these things are brutes. They go everywhere. This one will go, you can go up to 3,000 feet with sonar and TV on it, or just sonar. If it's totally surcharged, you don't want to be putting the camera in there, of course. And of course, you know, I think all of you know this that are on, but if you don't, just in case, sonar sees everything underwater. It's not going to see anything above the water. And a camera is going to see everything above the water. And people say, well, can't the camera see underwater? And yeah, if the water was nice and clear, you could see underwater. I mean, we ran a camera in the Coachella Valley Water Irrigation District in a large diameter pipe, and we saw fish swimming by us and everything else. It was totally clear. It was nice. But, you know, if you put it into the sewer, I've never seen in all my years in inspecting sewer any clear turds. I just haven't. They're always murking up the water. So therefore, the camera, even though it could see underwater, and for the most part in most of the sewers could handle the pressure of being underwater, it's not going to see anything because the water's not clear. So, but the sonar, it don't care. It will pick up off of that. Sonar is a slow process. Sonar, unlike cameras and everything else, operates off of sound, as we talked about earlier. So sound is always slower than sight. And so therefore, because of that, you need to run it so that when the sonar leaves your sonar head and comes back, it's able to get to your sonar head. If your sonar head is gone, it won't get to it. So therefore, sonars normally run around 25 feet a minute, never more than 30 feet a minute. You'll hear people say, well, we figured out a way to do it, to run it faster. And I always tell them, oh, that's great. then you should get a Nobel Prize for figuring out how to speed up the speed of sound, because that's what it's based on. So if you're out running sonar and you're running it faster than what the manufacturer's specs are on it there, then you're not getting really any true data on your way back. The other thing is that if you bury your sonar head, if the debris is too high, you can see, like in this particular case, how the sonar head is very low. So in that one with the debris that had over 30 inches of debris in it there, this would just be pulling through the what we call the mud and or the debris. You would not get any readings that way. So in order to handle that, we have floats. And with the floats, unique thing is with the gold cable on your CUES equipment, you're able to pull up to 5,400 feet, over a mile of distance in one shot for sonar and for CCTV or HDTV with the CUES duct. Lighting is very good on up to 96 inch diameter pipe with both the duct and the odds 2 camera. So that is no problem at all within itself. So I think I've given you the information, or at least the information I know. Like I said, I imagine there's some of you in the crowd here that have extensive sonar experience. My hat's off to you, and probably have other benefits and things that you'd like to share. But since it's not an open forum, you can put them in the Q&A, or you can contact me on email or whatever else. I'm always happy to hear of new stuff and learn myself, even though I'm an old crotchety guy at this point in time. I'm always looking forward to the new information and the way people handle things.
All right. Thank you so much, Ed. And as Ed mentioned, that does wrap up our webinar. We want to thank you all for attending today and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding sonar, please feel free to reach out directly to Ed. His contact details are on your screen. You can also always visit the CUES website for more information. Once again, thank you all for attending.